Views expressed on this program are those of the producers and individuals appearing on this program and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Sun Prairie Media Center staff, its video service providers, or the staff and elected officials of the City of Sun Prairie.
Hello and welcome to Real Reviews. I'm Jamison Rabbit, and this week I am joined by a friend of the show, a previous guest, Mr. Gershon Porter. Sir, how are you?
Doing good. Thanks to be here.
Yeah. We've been trying to get you. Now, you were on the show last summer when we were in quarantine.
Yes, I was. We have been trying to get me to the studio, which I love it.
Yeah.
And it's amazing. So I'm glad to be here, though.
I also appreciate it because I recorded that quarantine episode and people only saw your head in extreme close-up because I didn't know what I was doing.
Yes, so. We had a couple camera difficulties there, but yeah. It still was a good episode.
It was an excellent episode. You should go check that out in our previous episodes. It was a good one last summer, but this week we're here to talk about a bunch of movies, and I'm going to go ahead and get us started with what we have on the marquee this week. First, we have a film called Those Who Wish Me Dead, which is currently in theaters and on HBO Max, from director Taylor Sheridan. This film stars Angelina Jolie as a lady named Hannah. Hannah is a smoke jumper, a firefighter, if you will. She's got a little trauma in her life that is keeping her from being able to do the job. The film is mainly about these two sociopathic assassins, though, who are out hunting for a man who knows something that could incriminate their boss, played by Tyler Perry, or something. Not quite sure what he knows, but it's when they find this man and kill him very on in the movie. It's his son that escapes and kind of serves as the loose thread that they have to take care of. Meanwhile, you have Hannah, who is in the forest of Montana. She's been traumatized by a recent event. She's still very shaken up by it. And of course, the assassins, the kid, the local sheriff, played by John Barenthal, and his wife, played by Medina Senghor, all get embroiled in a deadly chase through the forest as time is ticking. A forest fire is raging. The killers are after the killers, by the way, two brothers played by Nicholas Holt and Aidan Gillen. It says in the description that they're supposed to be twin brothers, but I think they're actually 20 years difference in age.
Did it say that?
In the IMDb, it says twin assassins.
Oh,
and I'm like, they're not even fraternal twins. These guys are 20 years apart.
No.
The killers are ruthless, they're after this kid. Your thoughts on Those Who Wish Me Dead, sir?
So, going to be honest with you, if you didn't have me on the show, I wouldn't have watched this movie.
Yeah.
And I am very happy that I did watch it.
Nice.
Because at first, I thought it was just a run-of-the-mill, old employee tired of doing the job, ready to die, and then something happens halfway through and I'm totally in by the whole premise of the movie, and I'm ready for the ride. I love the different storylines eventually combining. Mm-hmm. It was a good ride, and the acting is really good.
Yeah.
It's not stellar, but they do the job and they make you invest in those characters. One person that is stellar, though, that little kid.
He's great.
He is really good.
Yeah, let's...
He's starting to make me cry a little.
Finn Little is his name.
Oh, man. He's going to be something special in years to come. I'm very excited to see what he does next. Angelina Jolie does a good job.
I see, and I thought that, for me, my favorite scenes were the scenes that involved her and him together.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it was kind of the heart of the movie. She started to get a little redemption as she realized, I can make up for what happened before, and I can save this kid.
Yeah, I think they harped on that a little too much, but it's the get the tearjerker. That's what they were doing,
yeah.
And it worked. Honestly, her scenes are only really great with that kid.
Sure.
Everything else is kind of like, that's just Angelina Jolie. She's just there. But with that kid, amazing, amazing.
John Barenthal playing basically what John Barenthal plays in everything he does. I feel like he just has this, like, I'm going to take this role to the Punisher. I'm going to take it to whatever you need. I'm going to be this guy.
He knows what he can do. He knows he can do it well. And he knows he can do it every time perfectly.
Yeah.
So stay in your wheelhouse.
Yeah. I did think there were some missed opportunities in here with the story. Like, I felt like the Tyler Perry portion and, like, the reason why he's going after this kid and what the guy knew and all that was left really unexplained.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted a little more of that. I also felt like the assassins almost felt like they got dumber as the movie went along.
Yeah.
Like they're at the beginning, they were cohesive. They had a plan. And then it's like when things started to break down, they're just like, I don't know, just fire randomly at stuff.
I took it to that they couldn't think on their feet.
Right.
They were clearly planned out guys. If the plan broke down, the idea is to bug out, not to continue going. Yeah. Even the other one was like, we're getting real messy here. What are we doing? And he was like, we got to keep going forward. So I can see that's their fault and their abilities, which made sense because once that fire happened, they were really out of their element totally, and they were just trying to figure out how to get the job done and do what they say they were supposed to be doing.
Right. I was also kind of hoping that the forest fire would be more of a character. Once you introduce the forest fire into this and you have firefighters and all this, I was like, okay, I hope the forest fire plays more of a role.
True.
I mean,
but how much of the fire could you really use? Because it's a wildfire and it spreads really fast,
right,
which I like that they made it spread fast and not slow. But you can only use so much of it as a character in this, especially in that wide open space. That was amazing that they made that space feel so wide.
Well, that's the strength of Taylor Sheridan as a director. I mean, he directs Yellowstone and Hell or High Water and his last movie, Wind River. They all take place out in the wilderness. He loves using big open spaces. And that's what really drew me to this movie was the cast and then him. And he also wrote Sicario.
Okay.
So I think he does a great job at writing slow burn, intense thriller dramas and uses the space really well. And I part of me just wanted a little more of that out of him because he's done some great things.
Yeah.
Curious what you end up giving Those Who Wish Me Dead, sir.
Well, before I do that, I do like Tyler Perry in it. He surprised me. I love Tyler Perry in other stuff. His stuff is great. Don't get me wrong. It's crazy, but great. But when he's in other people's movies, he shines amazingly.
Yeah, I would have loved more of Tyler Perry.
Oh, so much more would have been great. And to know why they're so secretive about this would have been nice.
Yeah.
But I gave it a 4 out of 5.
Nice.
I was very pleased with this movie.
Solid,
very pleased.
Solid score.
Very pleased.
I gave it 3 out of 5. I enjoyed it. I just wish that some more things were fleshed out that I didn't quite get. I could have used 20 more minutes of this movie.
Yeah, definitely could have added to the end.
Add some Tyler Perry and flesh out that end of the story, the whys that I never felt like I got on.
Yeah, definitely.
It's an enjoyable film, and obviously we both recommend it. So again, it's playing in theaters and streaming on HBO Max right now. Another film that we saw in theaters, sir, what do you have for us?
We saw Spiral, starring Chris Rock, Max Mendenhall, and Samuel Jackson. It's actually 9th film in the Saw series. It's kind of the first Saw spinoff as well. Chris Rock plays a cop trying to figure out the killings of Saws that they kind of use. Jigsaw, I forgot his name, Jigsaw. There's killings like Jigsaw, but we all know Jigsaw is dead at this point. So he's trying to figure out what's going on in this small town. It's very interesting to see him be in this role. I was very surprised, in not the best way, with Chris Rock in this. But it is a Saw movie, so you're going to get gore. It's there. So if you're looking for that, this is definitely a movie for you to check out.
Yeah.
But what did you think, Jamison?
Yeah, I struggled with the tone of this film. So I was really curious because of Chris Rock's involvement, because it is very against type. And I was interested in that because we've seen Jordan Peele.
Yes.
Come from the comedy world.
Yes.
And do amazing things with a similar genre. And I'm like, okay, I'm here for it. I like this. Even though I'm not a fan of the Saw films, I was kind of intrigued by it. But it opens with this gruesome murder when a cop finds himself in a Saw trap.
Yes.
And we get a gruesome murder. And then it immediately cuts to Chris Rock's character, being like, it felt like standard issue. Like, I'm not getting a rookie partner. You didn't tell me what to do. And then he launched into 4 minutes out of his act about divorce and women. And I was all over the place, what tone is this? And then we're going right back into it. And then Samuel Jackson shows up, and he's doing Sam Jackson things, which I love. But it felt like I was never on sure footing with this, and it felt like they were, I mean, there was so much of this that was like, if you love Saw movies, you're gonna, this is like, hey, we got another one going on.
Yeah.
We got a guy, yeah. Gruesome killings. He's got a doll of his own.
Yes.
And I don't know, a lot of it fell flat for me with that.
Yeah, it very much with the cop stuff felt like Last Action Hero or Lethal Weapon with the chief and all that. But then Chris Rock has a difficulty in not being Chris Rock.
Right. It felt like, oh, this Chris Rock playing a cop.
Exactly. I thought this was going to be the role where you see him being very dramatic, very mm-hmm. good at that, and
that's
breakout.
What we needed.
Comedy is all about timing and controlling the room. And horror is all about timing and controlling the room. And I thought he would match perfectly with this. Unfortunately, not so much. He can't break out of that mode of being Chris Rock.
Yeah.
He can't break out of role of being entertaining for stand-up reasons. Not for shock and value, but just be a comedy. That's him.
He needed to disappear into this role a little
yep.
more. It felt like he was too self-aware almost. I mean, at one point, there was a groaner where he had to mention New Jack City.
Yeah.
And that was like a big eye roll for me.
That was very bad.
Like, okay.
I was like, yeah. Did he just say that?
Are we going to get a KRS-One reference later on? I don't know. I felt like he was really miscast. CB4 is what I was going for.
Yeah, CB4. I was about to say CB4.
It just felt like he was really miscast in this. And he didn't have the dramatic chops that this film needed.
So the thing I found out is that there's a Tyler Perry again. You know, Tyler Perry's movie, there's a joke about Chris Rock being a cop or something, where Paramount felt bad about the joke, told Chris Rock they would
get...
Yes. So this was making up for that, giving him this Saw movie.
Wow.
It's been years in the planning, but that's what it made. And I was like, that is ridiculous that that's what you guys
that's
did.
That's not how we should do things.
No, it shouldn't. But everybody else in this movie is good. They're okay. The villain, okay. Samuel Jackson is Samuel Jackson.
Yeah.
He plays Samuel Jackson,
does. Yeah, exactly.
And he knows he can do that, but he does it so well. The problem is they don't know what tone they want to go with.
Yeah.
Like, you're throwing a lot of side jokes in here, but then horrible accidents with people, horrible Saw things with people. And I'm like, make a decision.
It felt like the tension that they tried to build, to me, the build of their tension was really based just on the familiarity
exactly.
of the Saw movies.
Exactly.
I mean, in fact, to the point where at one point, Chris Rock finds himself in the situation from the first Saw movie.
Yeah.
And I'm like, really, we're doing this?
Yeah.
We're going to handcuff a guy to a pipe in the bathroom now?
It's a legitimate callback, but it's also like, why?
It felt like branch off. Do your thing.
Because they've done that callback in another Saw
exactly.
movie already.
We've already seen it. And I mean, I don't know. It also, I mean, I felt like the inevitable twist at the end felt really telegraphed.
Very much so.
And so that kind of was frustrating. And there's, you know, like most of these Saw movies, there's a lot of leaps of logic that I just struggled to make with it.
Yeah.
A lot of like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
How did that, I don't know, I kind of struggle with that. The upside, though, it's nice and short. It's 90 minutes.
It is
short. We're in or out.
It is short.
Like I said, I'm not a big Saw franchise guy. I've watched them all. It's an upgrade over the Jigsaw movie, which came out a couple years ago. That was my worst movie of the year it came out. So this is an upgrade over that.
I didn't even
for me.
See that one.
Yeah, you don't need to.
I seen the first Saw and the second Saw and pieces of the other ones. The first one is still one of the best ones.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Because it's an actual thriller and not just gore for gore's sake.
It was interesting, but then I felt like as that franchise went along, it felt like they didn't think it was going to go that far.
Nope.
And so then they had to start piecing together backstory that a lot of times didn't make sense and then bring back characters somehow.
Yes.
Like, oh man, we're
yes.
still going, guys. And, they had to find ways to make the storyline make sense, and it just didn't. And by the end, it was awful.
Like, this movie had a chance to revitalize this franchise
yeah.
with the Book of Saw, which is the side title of it. And I think they fell short of that mark. They could have really brought more energy to this franchise. I technically see where they can go with the next one,
yeah.
but you shouldn't go there.
No, I'm sure they will, though.
They will. They did Saw 3D. They're going to do it.
We have a lot of signposts in the past showing that they will continue going with this no matter what because, you know, they're usually successful in the box office.
True.
So that always helps. Curious what you end up giving Spiral, though.
I believe I gave Spiral a 2 out of 5.
Oh, it says here 2.5.
Oh, yeah.
I was trying to
give it the benefit of the doubt. It started out really good. It started out really interesting. The trailers are very interesting.
Yeah, the trailer had me.
And then it just started going downhill.
Things fell apart. I ended up giving it 2 out of 5. It's below mediocre. Not terrible. Not the worst of the Saw franchise. I don't know if that's damning of faint praise, but I don't know. You check it. If you like the Saw franchise, I'm sure you'll see it regardless. So, the next movie we have, sir, is our streaming spotlight, where we watched a film called The Woman in the Window from director Joe Wright. This film stars Amy Adams as a lady named Anna. She is an agoraphobic woman who is stuck inside her brownstone in New York, spying on her neighbors. She's been separated from her husband and child, but she speaks to them on the phone constantly. Her husband, voiced and eventually played by Anthony Mackie. And it's when a new family moves in across the street. The Russells move in across the street. She has a new fixation. And one by one, each member of the Russell family comes on over to meet her, each of them with their own story. We have the son, Ethan, played by Fred Hechinger, who shows up. He brings a gift, brings a candle, and also a warning about his father being abusive. And then his father, Alistair, played by the great Gary Oldman, he comes over. It's a bit menacing. He's mm-hmm. Gary Oldman. And then one night, Jane, the wife, comes over to help calm Anna, who has been become agitated by some Halloween revelers. And Jane is played by Julianne Moore. And the two of them sit and they drink some wine and they chat. But this sitting around drinking wine is a bit of an issue because Anna is taking some pretty strong medications for her unexplained condition. And this is when things start to kind of spiral, to borrow another phrase. So the next night, Anna witnesses a fight as she spies on her neighbors. And she sees Alistair stab his wife, Jane. And things get out of control. Her hysteria worsens. The police come and show her that Jane Russell is still alive and not the woman that she's been describing. Jane Russell's right here, played by Jennifer Jason Leigh. What are you talking about, crazy woman? Her downstairs neighbor, to add to the Russell-ness, David, played by Wyatt Russell, no relation, and he shows up kind of, he's in and out of the picture. I feel like a lot of it is just to provide some mystery and maybe drop some red herrings into the mystery of what's going on here. And really, the film borrows really heavily from Alfred Hitchcock's Rear Window, of someone who just watches what they think is a murder happening across the street, and no one believes them. And most of the major plot points come from that. But curious what you thought about Woman in the Window.
Yeah, it's very much old cat lady in the house seeing stuff. The movie, I love the mystery in the movie. The only problem is the way they get that mystery is just not telling you anything. That's not how you set up a mystery. Like, I need you to set up a better mystery. The characters are really good. The acting is really good. I honestly think she's going crazy. Yeah. Like, honestly.
Yeah, you can see it in her face.
Exactly. I mean, it also is a great don't drink and take pills.
Yeah, right. When the doctor says don't mix this with alcohol.
He really means that. It's just that I wish there was a bigger climax for it. It felt very soft of a climax to where the police should have known what was going on. And that's just a little disturbing.
They kind of blew her off pretty quickly.
Exactly. And I was like, hold on. She told you someone is been stabbed. You didn't seem to do any investigation. Like, we watch CSI. We know those little lights. You can find blood easily. Did you guys not even check? So that was a little, way it was written was a little disappointing. Mm-hmm. But overall, I still enjoyed it. I still really enjoyed it.
I felt like it was, a lot of this movie was really an exercise in copying other films in this genre. Like, this is one of my favorite genres, is like the psychological thriller mystery. Who's been murdered? I love that genre of film, you know, and you start to wonder, like, is she being gaslit? What really happened here? But I like the performances, but I thought a lot of the stuff within the making of the movie felt really uninspired to me.
Yeah.
And then I read some stuff about the behind the scenes of the journey this film took to get on screen. And it makes a lot of sense because there was the guy who wrote the book that this was based on is a psychopath. In fact, they're making a movie about the author himself because his story is nuts. Oh, the guy who wrote the screenplay off of the book said, this is the worst experience I've ever had. The film was shot and reshot and reshot because audience was like, this doesn't make any sense.
Oh.
And so they reshot again. They're like, it still doesn't make any sense.
Okay.
And it took a long journey to get to where it is. And a lot of the people said, I just want this movie to be done.
Yeah. there's a point where you're like, okay, can we figure out the conclusion of this? Because you guys are doing too much. And I like, they made that house look massive.
And that was built on a soundstage. I mean, that was a massive house.
They made that house look massive, which is not the thing you wanted to take away from the movie. It was like, oh, the house looked really big.
Yeah, yeah.
No. But yeah, they really stretched it out unnecessarily. They could have got to the end, got to where they needed to be. I see where they were going, and I got there before they did, so I had to wait for them to get there.
I hate that. We've and talked about that so many times on the show.
So bad.
When you're sitting there just waiting going, yep, we're going there. Yeah. I know exactly. Let's just keep up, you know. That's kind of my thoughts. I thought that there was a more effective thriller in here somewhere.
Yes.
And we just didn't get it on the screen. And so that just got a little frustrating. But what did you end up giving The Woman in the Window?
I give The Woman in the Window a 3 stars.
Yeah. I gave it 2.5. Kind of right down the middle, you know, like it wasn't good, wasn't bad. I watched it. There was great performances and a frustrating story. And so I can neither recommend nor unrecommend this film. But Woman in the Window, Gershon tepidly recommends. It's a 3 if you want to.
If you don't have anything to watch and you might want to fall asleep.
Don't take pills, though.
Liquor.
We don't need that. sir, movie throwback segment every week. I'm asking my special guests to select a film that, for whatever reason, maybe it's special to you, maybe it's just something you've never seen or whatever. And this week, what did you select for us?
I selected Cool Runnings, starring Leon Robertson, Dougie E. Doug, and John Candy. It is a story based on the true story of the Jamaican bobsled team. It is a great movie. You get to see people trying something they've never done before out of near desperation of trying to go to the Olympics and win a gold medal. The main character wanted to go for sprinting. An accident happens where he doesn't qualify, but he is still determined to make it to the Olympics and win a gold medal like his father did. So he comes up with a plan to be a bobsledding team.
Why not? You're from Jamaica.
Exactly. Jamaica never had a bobsledding team, never had snow. But there's one man on the island that knows how to bobsled, and that's John Candy. Late great John Candy is amazing in this movie. He's funny, yet dramatic. He moves this movie along, and it works really good with him. What did you think about it?
I love Cool Runnings, and the characters are fun. I mean, it's based on the actual guys that went to the 88 Olympics, and I remember watching that. It was a great story. And so these characters are a ton of fun. I've always loved Sanka. Saw Dougie Doug in this, and then he was in Class Act the next year.
Yes.
And I'm like, I'm on with this guy.
I
love him. Leon, who played Dennis, he was in Above the Rim the next year. Loved him in that. He was great. But John Candy, like you said, he adds the heart to this film.
He does.
He ties it all together. It like he did in most everything he did. He'd be hilarious. He'd be, you know, he'd do dumb physical comedy, but he'd bring that big heart to the film to bring it all together. And it's a cast you can root for. And I looked it up to see how well was this movie received, because I know I've loved it. I've watched it many times. I rewatched it again this week for this. This movie, they made it for $14 million back in 1993. It pulled in $154 million. Nice little return.
Yes.
At the time, it was the biggest live-action hit that Disney had ever made.
And that's the amazing part, that it's made by Disney.
Yeah.
Like, this was one of the first live-action movies Disney made that didn't have a so-called happy ending.
Right.
They didn't change the story.
Wasn't based off an old novel.
Exactly. I like that they didn't change the story, and they showed that everything they did, even learning to bobsled, feeling through all that adversity, learning something they've never done, getting bullied by the other bobsledders, they didn't win, but still got the respect of other bobsledders and were able to come back next year. I don't think they've ever still won.
No.
But
no.
They still compete, and they do a good job of it. And I love that they didn't change that story. I think it's amazing.
Yeah, it's fun. And like you said, it's cool that they didn't change the ending, because you would expect Disney movie, like, and then we'll just a little artistic license, and then they got a medal. And and then you look it up and go, wait a minute, it didn't happen.
Exactly.
One of my favorite things, though, is that 1988 Olympics has spawned off two movies that I enjoy about two different groups, two different people who had amazing stories, very similar. Cool Runnings with the Jamaican bobsled team, and then Eddie the Eagle, the British ski jumper who was constantly crashing. They made the movie starring Taron Egerton and Hugh Jackman a few years ago, was also at that Olympic Games.
Now I have a reason to go see that
movie.
People
were just crashing all over the place doing things they never knew how to do.
I definitely have a reason to go see Eddie the Eagle.
It's a fun movie.
I never got around to it, but now I have a reason.
Yeah, it's an enjoyable film. So Cool Runnings, man. I love it. I mean, was there like a specific reason that Cool Runnings did speak to you for some reason?
Besides the point of seeing someone try something and not succeed and be the number one in it, but yet still get that, I saw something on TikTok where this guy explained Cool Runnings, how the guys did everything right, and at the end of it, it was just the sled didn't work out. So sometimes you can do everything right you're supposed to, and sometimes the sled just doesn't work. But that doesn't mean you don't stop trying. And that was a beautiful message to me, and
yeah.
I thought this movie really is more special than I thought it was.
I like when we end the show on an upbeat note, because we had three middle just thrillers, kind of.
Very
people
true.
People were chasing each other, killing people. It's just Cool Runners, man. Let's just run the bobsleds out. Let's take a look at what is coming soon, though, sir. The weekend of Memorial Day weekend. That's May 28th, I believe. We have a few movies coming out. The first one is, speaking of Disney, it is their new live-action film, Cruella. Loosely based on 101 Dalmatians. I don't see a lot of Dalmatians in this
there
movie.
There was two Dalmatians that trailer.
I didn't see 101 of them. Emma Stone starring as Cruella as Disney continues to branch off with their villains. I don't know if her and Maleficent are going to form a super team.
It's possible. It's very much so possible. I'm trying to see what's the next villain. I'm thinking Shere Khan.
Ooh, maybe.
I like that. Let's see his story.
Yeah.
Let's see the origin of Shere Khan.
Who knows, man? I think they're just going to make every character into a movie at some point. It's Disney.
It's Disney. They can do it.
They got money. Also coming out that weekend is a sequel that has been long in the making. A Quiet Place Part 2, a film that was supposed to have come out a little over a year ago. John Krasinski made this one again, starring again his wife, Emily Blunt. And we pick up the events of what has happened out in the world when the monsters that have very good hearing come chasing after you.
I am very excited.
I am too. That first one was one of the best theater experiences
so
I've had in a while.
Good.
It was you could hear a pin drop in my theater.
Like, there's two theater experiences I always go back to. It's Endgame and this.
Yeah, yeah.
Just how quiet it was.
I'm hopeful
it was amazing.
We get that again.
Oh.
We'll see. And then the last film coming out that weekend is a film called The World to Come, which is a period piece set in 1850s New York with two couples that are dealing with isolation and the struggles of relationships. Stars Vanessa Kirby and Casey Affleck, among others. Those are the films that will be coming to you on Memorial Day weekend. Before we move any further, though, we want to thank our sponsor, Marcus Theaters, The Palace here in Sun Prairie. Thank you for sponsoring this program. We always appreciate going to sit in a dream lounger. Gershon and I sat in matching dream loungers this week and watched the movie, and it was,
yes, we did.
I love it. So
great moments.
Thank you to the Palace for making all of that possible. Next week, sir, I am going to be joined by another guest host, Jason Spencer. We're going to be talking about Zack Snyder's Army of the Dead, Nicolas Cage's Willy's Wonderland, as well as another fun throwback. I hope. I don't know what it's going to be. I hope it's enjoyable, but that's all going to be happening next week. Sir, thank you for joining me on the show. I hope we have you on again very soon.
Thank you for having me. This was amazing. I cannot lie. I love it here.
Oh, boy. That's good to hear. I like hearing those things. But until next week, when we're talking about all kinds of fun movies, I'm Jamison.
I'm Gershon.
Thanks for watching.